Dear Personal Thoughts Tracker, I know it's been a hot minute, but honestly, I just haven't had the energy. Things haven't been going great. You know, a couple weeks ago when we got in trouble for going to the Rift and then Mara got leashed, that was bad. That was really bad. And now everyone's being so weird and not talking. And I know we pretend not to be friends at school because of the class crossing thing, but it's starting to not feel like pretend. Mara is obsessed with her leash. She says that she can figure a way around it, and that's great, but that's all she thinks about. Charlie has herself locked away in her room, and she used to phase into my room every morning. And she hasn't done that in weeks. She won't even tell me why. And Daniel, something's definitely wrong with Daniel. You know, I was so excited to get a roommate, and before we went to the Rift, he was so cool. But now, it's like he's not even here. I don't know what's happening with my friends, but I need to help them. I just wish they would talk to me. When we came to this planet, I was really scared. But then we met Charlie, and then Mara, and Daniel, and things felt okay. I'm just feeling really alone. At least I have you, Lou.
Soul strong, heart of gold, shining bright, powerful. It's a new world that we're making. No limits and it's all for the taking. Since we're here, let's unleash our full potential. Never back down, no, we never settle. Finally got a reason to be here now. We don't even care how. Let's go. It's a revolution. We ain't supposed to be here. Here we are. It's a revolution. Unleash, let's go. Take the last stand now.
Charlie, it's been about 2 weeks since you began your internship with Omnio. They put you with the other interns. You've been cleaning up data, making spreadsheets, all of that boring stuff, but you have been crushing it. And once more, you've had FaceTime with Dante Aoki, the CEO and founder of Omnio, a super billionaire, a genius, a tech innovator, and you are in the middle of another conversation on a video call with him, alone in your room.
Thank you so much for doing these again. I know we've been doing it, but I appreciate your time so much.
Charlie, I'm impressed. I mean, at such a young age, your work ethic, your ideas, you're just different from every other intern we've ever worked with. I'm blown away. You have a keen mind, and that's something to be celebrated.
Thank you. I mean, everyone always said I was different, but they never really said it in a good way. Their tone, but...
And you are a comic genius as well. I'll tell you, though, I don't usually do this. However, I've asked my colleagues to keep tabs on you and send me information. Give me one quick second. Yeah, Lena is always bothering me. I'm kidding. She's keeping me updated on everything that's happening. But yeah, I don't usually do this. But again, like the information that you have coming and all the work that you're doing, it's just, it's amazing. And typically we give the grunt work to our interns, and the spreadsheets that you're turning in, the analytics, they're in the caliber of someone who's top of the class in college. I'm literally blown away.
Wow. You know, I'm not trying to brag, but numbers have always kind of been easy for me, so I honestly, I haven't minded it. What I've appreciated so much is sitting in on the meetings and everything. Getting to see you work is kind of incredible.
No need to flatter me. I appreciate that, though. You know, So now that we've gotten to know each other a little bit more, I typically ask this of my executives. Now, I've got a little riddle for you, and I'd like to kind of pick your brain, see where you go with this one as well. Because again, you're so creative. So the riddle is this. You're standing on the surface of the earth. Now you walk 1 mile south, 1 mile west, and 1 mile north. You end up exactly where you started. Where are you?
The North Pole?
Why?
Well, it's just kind of, it's obvious, right? It's just, I can't.
It's amazing. I mean, again, most of my executives can't even figure that out. The fact that you get that right, it just blows my mind.
Really?
You're 16. You shouldn't be this intelligent.
Wow. Honestly, my teachers never really seemed to have much faith in me, so getting to sort of explore what I'm capable of has been incredible. I never would have considered myself, I don't know, smart based off of what other people tell me, but I'm pretty quick, I guess.
Yeah, well, you know, if I let people dictate my future, I never would be where I'm at now with Omnio. You're definitely blossoming, and it's phenomenal. At the pace that you're going, you'll be unstoppable. Yeah, I think about, I want to be able to help you as well, because everything that you're doing is on a different caliber. Tell me more about yourself, though. I don't feel like I know enough.
I've never felt like I was anything much special based off of what, you know, teachers around me say. I always knew I was kind of different from the other kids, and I never really did a good job at fitting in, but finally feels like that's not such a bad thing anymore.
Yeah, it is pretty hard to feel like an outcast. For me, I never really realized it until I grew up that I was always the outsider looking in. Felt like one of those Christmas movies where I'm sitting outside in the snow while all these families are enjoying their turkey dinners on the inside with warmth and songs, and I just never understood that.
Yeah, I think I know what that feels like. Kind of like there hasn't been a place where I belonged.
Yeah.
Dante, I would love if you rolled the adult move empathize for me. Roll 2d6 plus your mundane.
Okay, I rolled a 7. Mundane is -1. But I also have an influence, don't I?
You do.
So I would be an 8.
All right. With a hit, Charlie, you are having a special moment with the founder of Omnio right now. Reveal a vulnerability or mark a condition.
I admit I've been a huge fan of your work kind of since I was a kid. I was little, just watching all these great technological feats kind of take place, and I was always kind of a dream to get to meet you. So, well, I'm a little bit of a fangirl, I have to admit.
Wow, thank you. I appreciate that a lot. Thank you very much. I get that often, but coming from you, it does make an impact. Like I said, I there's not many people I've found like you. I see myself in you, surprisingly, and I made my first million before I was 20. That takes a special kind of person to do that. But
do
I do want to ask
you. Make $1 million?
Oh, easily. With where your mind at, the creativity, how you think outside of the box, it's just an untapped potential. And I have to say, I would like to know, what drew you to Omnio most? What made you want to work with us? What made us so lucky to have someone as intelligent as you?
Well, you guys are doing things that nobody else has ever been able to even get close to doing. It's incredible. And I've always wanted to know just how you do it. How do you come up with the ideas that you have? I wanted to be on the inside of that.
Yeah. That makes sense to answer that. I think it just comes down to, again, having the right people, having the right team, and being able to bounce ideas off in a safe environment. And with that, we just say, shoot for the moon. Whatever you think's possible, we'll make it happen here at Omnia. Wow. So, I had a question for you.
Yeah.
You said you were in a boarding school?
Yeah.
Yeah, how's that going for you?
Well, if I'm honest, it kind of feels like I'm in a whole other world in here. But there's a whole strict set of rules and teachers are really hard on us, but I mean, I'm trying to find my place here. It's all right.
Yeah, how do you typically deal with the stress of boarding school, the teachers and such?
Well, full transparency, some of these meetings don't really line up with my class schedule all the time, so I just kind of haven't always been there in class. They're not the happiest about it, but I think that it's all going to be worth it.
Interesting. So when it comes to scheduling and being in person, if you're not for it, you're not there, but you still get the work done. Is that what I'm hearing correctly?
Yeah, I do enough to make sure that I'm not in any more trouble than I usually find myself in.
Yeah. Now, is that a quality you get from your parents, or is that just something that you've developed on your own?
I'm not really much like my parents. Really, it's just my dad. He's a businessman too. He's an investor. His name is Gerard King.
Gerard King.
Yeah, he mostly is all work and no play, and he's really the only one I got. So.
Gerard King with Redwood?
Yeah.
Very cool. Yeah, we've actually worked with him. His company's Redwood Capital. They do a very, very good job of investing. We've actually worked hand in hand with them quite a bit. They do. Makes sense that the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree. Do you miss your father much?
We talk here and there. He's kind of a busy guy, you know, so we talk when we can.
Yeah. Do you know I got a brother in boarding school?
Oh, really?
Yeah, I miss him. He's a good kid. Love him. I check in once in a while, but I don't get to hear him from too often. Do you talk to your parents often, or your father, excuse me?
Yeah, well, I'll give him the weekly call to let him know I'm doing okay, and he's always checking in with texts to keep tabs on me, because he really likes to know what I'm up to at all times, but...
That's great, though. I mean, isn't that awesome? Like, yeah, a parent who loves you? For me, my father actually left. He left us at a young age, so it was just me and my mom. Oh. And, you know, my mom, she did the best she could with what she had, and she became a very successful woman. But my father, Clark, you know, him not being around, at least I had my mom as cold as it was. Do you have a, you know, you have a good relationship with your father at all?
Well, you know, my mom left too when I was young, so it's been just me and my dad, but we're not super close because he's always working. He just seems a little bit too busy for me these days.
I'm so sorry to hear that.
I mean, it's okay. He's, you know, he has his own things going on and I have mine.
Yeah, good. And you're having a good time at boarding school and your father's there when you need him, right?
Yeah. Great time at boarding school. Dad's there. We call all the time. Yeah.
Okay, so listen, I don't want to take up too much of your time, but I definitely wanted to ask you this. I've really been enjoying the work that you've been putting in. I can't say that enough. There's something about you that is just special. I'm hoping that, someone of your ability, you'd be interested in potentially taking a formal position at Omnia. Give it time, of course, but we'd like to extend this opportunity for you. Now, before you answer, I want you to think about this. Now, if you were, in fact, to become a full-time employee over at Omnia, we would provide all the luxuries. Money is not an issue. You would have a black card, and whatever you'd like to spend on, and unlimited spending. You'd have a personal home base. You can choose anywhere around the world. It's not mandatory for you to go into meetings, as much as you don't like that. You could travel, you could do work all over the world, so you're essentially a free bird. Nothing holding you down, nothing binding you down, and of course, This is after your 4-year boarding school, but the opportunity is there if you'd like to take it. Now think about that.
Yeah. Wow. Thank you. Are you sure? I mean, I'm still in high school. I'm only 16. I've only been your intern for a couple of weeks.
Yes, I've been watching the work that you do, and the few weeks that you have, you've stumped many of our top executives. Now again, we're a world-class company. We only work with the best. So the fact that you're putting these people, let's say a fifth grade level compared to you, I think I've made a strong choice.
When you say working wherever I choose, is it okay if I keep working where I am remotely, if that's what I choose?
Whatever you choose is yours. You can have anything. Hey, can I show you something really cool?
Yeah.
Okay, check this out. All right, so I have an amazing prototype. Now, let me remind you, this is not gonna be ready for about 4 years, and speaking of you and graduating in about 4 years, this is kind of works out perfectly, wouldn't you say? Let me show you.
Yeah.
So we've been working on this prototype for a while. This watch, simple enough, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, in actuality, this watch provides the opportunity to have a projection, a full holographic projection. Not only
Dante presses a button on the watch, and Charlie, it is amazing. A full screen, 12 inches across, pops up in the air in front of him. You actually watch him interacting with the display. There's a sense of tactileness to it, as though he is interacting with something more substantial than light.
What do you think?
How is that possible? We have never had anything like that before.
Yeah, I mean, what we're working on is nanobot technology. Now, this is extremely rare. Again, this is a prototype. We've been developing this for about 5-6 years. It's not going to be ready for another 16 weeks, 16 quarters. However, we have 3 of these that have been developed and are ready for, hopefully will be ready in time for mass production in 4 years' time. But what I'd really like to send you, one of our specific, our very rare prototypes. What do you think?
You have 3 and you want to send one to me?
Yeah. I want you to tinker with it. I want you to play around with it. I want you to figure out what you think we could do better at Omnio. This may or may not be another test. Who knows?
Well, that would be incredible. I'd love to get my hands on it. I'm actually between places right now in my boarding school. I'm between dorms. We don't really have an address. You know, I really appreciate it, but I just don't think you could get that to me.
Okay. So you're between addresses at your dorm.
Right.
Interesting. I thought that Well, yeah, I actually thought that you were going to be a bit more excited.
I am. I mean, okay, I don't have an address right now, but give me a couple days to just get that sorted out, get myself settled into one dorm, and I'll get something to you. I'll figure it out.
Charlie, I'm a little disappointed. I thought that you were completely for helping out Omnio.
I am. I'll get you an address. I just need a little bit of time.
It's okay. No pressure at all. If this is something that you're not interested in, I've got plenty of other interns that would be willing to take the position.
I am very interested. I'm sorry. It's just a weird... They moved my dorm because of a leak. So it just, I don't really have a room number, but I
will. Dante, will you please roll 2d6 plus your superior? Don't forget to add your extra point for influence.
I rolled a 7. Superior is 3, so 10 plus 1 is 11.
With an 11, Charlie, please take the condition insecure. You're losing him.
I'm sorry it's trouble, but I will... I'll figure it out. I definitely want this.
Okay, well... I hope that you do, and I hope that you're actually not messing with me. But, yeah, okay, well, I guess we'll look forward to talking to you again.
Okay. Yeah.
And with that, Dante leaves the call. Charlie, you're left in your room, alone. You have just been offered the world. And you're not quite sure how you can take it. But we'll move from that moment over to Mara's room in a different building in the dorms. She sits surrounded by open text filled with words and pictures and symbols in dead languages, languages that have never been spoken, words of power. The phone beside her lights up. It's Fee calling again. Emma, sitting on her bed, scrolling Riffside socials on her phone, looks over towards her roommate with a sneer. Mara, what do you do about the phone call?
I do what I did the last several times I got this phone call. I immediately silence it and turn my phone over. Except this time, I feel like I'm going to be a little more frustrated because it happens so often. I'll open the drawer next to my desk and I'll throw my phone in there and shut it.
As you kind of shut it with a snap, Emma looks over. Just, okay, what's your whole deal? This is a lot energy-wise, and it's just kind of stressful, if I'm being super honest.
I don't have a deal right now, Emma. Just don't want to answer a text message, that's all.
I mean, it's like 1,000 texts and like 1,000 calls and like... I don't know. I don't blame her. She, of course, like, an elemental would want to hang out with mages. But,
how do you even know who it is? You don't...
Who is it always? Like, you're
reading a bunch of... We're not even supposed to cross classes,
Well, you're reading a bunch of books, and you're, like, not even paying attention. And, yeah, I, like, see the very pink background pop up, and I can put two and two together. Thank you. God, you're a lot right now. I understand that you're leashed and it's sad or whatever, but like, I don't know.
Yeah, you don't know. So maybe stop trying to butt in and talk about it when you don't know what's going on.
Well, maybe if you talked about it with like people that understand, like other mages, you wouldn't be in the situation you're in socially.
Oh, yes. Oh my gosh, Emma, you're so right. God, why didn't I think about that before?
What? Wait, I can't tell. No, I like know you're being sarcastic, but I'm confused. What?
Oh, like, you're confused. That's a first. You don't understand the situation, Emma. And maybe it's because you're you.
What I am is a mage that walks around, is learning how to control her powers, and isn't leashed and therefore a social pariah in high school. That's what I am. What are you?
You're really... I never thought that I would try to put in a transfer request for a roommate, but I'm really considering it right now.
Look, I'm sorry. I don't mean to be harsh. I know you're going through a bunch right now. Like, look, why don't you come hang out with us? Look, Trevor's leashed too. He keeps turning into like a 50-year-old man, and that's really creepy. So like, it doesn't have to be the end of your world. You just have to like, be with us, you know?
You really think that I want to hang out with all of you when you've been talking about me behind my back all week?
Okay, but like everyone talks about
everyone. I tried to go out and read a book in the common area and Zane talked crap about me to my face. the rumors that have been spread around, and Emma, you're not doing anything to combat that as my roommate. Why do you think I want to talk to you about this? Why do you think I want to talk to anyone in this class about this when everyone has turned their backs on me? I was defending the rift, but that's not enough. None of you care about that. You care... I don't want to talk about it with you. And I hope you'll respect that.
Emma looks deeply ashamed and cowed. And as you look down, she actually like slides over closer and kind of puts her hand on your shoulder and gives it a little rub in an attempt at being comforting. Though it's the air between you is very awkward right now. Look, I'm sorry. I said a lot of things that I didn't mean. Why don't you come with us? Like, come with me. I'm gonna meet Hannah and Gregor. They're reopening the Maximum today. Like, why don't you just come and like take your mind off of it? It'll be okay.
Can I just have the room alone today?
Yeah.
I'm not feeling very social.
I understand. Okay. And she kind of like smooths out her skirt and walks to the door, shuts it quietly behind her, and you are left alone. What are you thinking about right now?
About how alone I feel in this situation. I can't hang out with my friends because they're of separate classes and I've already gotten punished for that. I'm deathly scared of the leash that I have on and how the elders haven't really told me when it's going to be taken off. And all of the mages have turned their backs on me. It feels very lonely right now.
Yeah. You think back. You think about being leashed. You're surrounded by books, research about leashes, about this very specific type of magecraft that can control people's powers. You don't know if you're looking for just more information. That's what you tell yourself, that you're just trying to understand it so you're less scared of it. But you know, you're looking for a way through it. And you're not finding answers here, not in the books provided to you by the school, but you go back and you think, your father, Puck, what was his ability again?
Emotional manipulation.
That's a very powerful, potentially dangerous ability, isn't it?
Yeah, it's heavily regulated. When he's not working, he has to wear a leash.
And your mind drifts back to that. He tried, for the most part, to not bring you with him during the process of leashing and unleashing. But sometimes, you know, bouncing a kid around, you were there. And you remember the chant that was part of this ritualistic leashing and unleashing, this control, the descent into personal will to accept and move with and move through a leash. And you remember those words, don't you?
I do. It's like three lines that they chant as they take off his leash.
What are the words, Mara?
They always say, your power is your own, your will is your own, your truth is your own, your future is your own.
And as you think those words, you can't tell if it's just because you need them to do something, to feel something. A little tingle, a thrill of energy, of potential, goes down your spine. But it's not enough to think them, Mara. You have to say them.
My will is my own. my truth is my own. My future is my own.
Every time you say it, you feel something. Not earth-shattering, but like something beginning, something building inside you. And you continue over and over. Remind us of those words again.
My will is my own. My truth is my own. My future is my own. My will is my own. My truth is my own. My future is my own.
And as you continue, you know that this is the path, and you focus and begin, and you breathe. And from there, we move from Mara's room to Fee and Daniel's room, on a different building, with a different energy entirely. Daniel looks like he's stalling, antsy, as if he wants to begin something of his own. And Fee looks down at her phone, another call sent directly to voicemail. Fee, how many times have you tried to call Mara?
I lost count. Yeah. It was probably a little too many.
You're right.
But I don't know how much is too much. If the device is supposed to be something that is immediate contact for another person, then isn't it okay if I use it? I don't understand.
Technology is tricky. There's a whole weird structure around it. It's a little hard to know when it's appropriate to text or call, or maybe everything can be cleared up if you just go. Visit her. Talk to her. Make it make sense.
Yeah. I just go to her dorm room in person. That might be better. I can probably do that. Will she answer the door? What if she's not there? What if she fell into a ditch or something, and that's why she's not answering her phone? But she's not in her dorm room. What if... I don't know.
Daniel, you notice that Fee gets a sudden stricken and panicked look on her face as she stands bolt upright from her bed and sprints for the door without a word. The door shuts. You're left alone. Finally, you can continue. What do you do?
I'm going to assess the situation.
Yeah. Go ahead. Roll 2d6 plus your superior for me.
I got a 12.
All right. With a 12, what are you trying to assess?
I'm going to see if Fee is anywhere around the dorm.
Oh. Now, you've watched Fee obsessively messaging the other girls. You know that she has been taken up for the last couple weeks with trying to keep the group together. She's not worried about you. You're in the room with her. You guys talk all the time. Honestly, maybe too much. You have things that you are thinking about, worried about on your own. You have a pretty unassailable understanding that if she's bolted out the room like that, she's worked herself into another tizzy and is probably headed for either the elemental or physical dorm. You have some time. What do you want to do with it?
All right, showtime. I take out little panels from behind my bookcase where I take out some wires and some old tech, and I take out this recording device that I put on my desk. I have a bunch of other metal scraps that I'm pulling out and putting them all, gathering them in front of me.
Daniel, where have you gotten all of these scraps from?
I am going to let them know right now. Hello? Recording? Okay, what's up? This is day 14 test mark A. I actually have quite a collection here. The science department here is very good at throwing away scraps that they don't need, but lucky for me, I need them. Okay, as always, control. Let's see if this is gonna be the same result as last time. Taking off the ring.
The moment you slip that ring off of your finger, you are doubled over with pain. Please roll plus danger for me.
Eight.
With an eight, you've done this a lot in the last 2 weeks. No condition, but it doesn't feel great.
As expected, ring off equals pain. Still here. Yep, not a birthmark. This chip that I've had has been here for 14 days now. There's still a connection with the ring and the chip. I think I'll call the chip Frito. Because, you know, corn, chip, Frito. Whatever, you'll get it when you record, when you listen back to this. Okay, so Frito over here definitely has some sort of radio transmission with this. Luckily, we've been running through every single code I can think of, and this new device right here that I got from the science department should make the capacity go out to, I don't know, 35% more. And also, little tip, Daniel, future Daniel, it's a great thing you have these earth powers, because the minerals that I can control with this power, like, I can actually fix up all sorts of tech that I couldn't fix up back home. So make sure you use that in your noggin for next time we get to actually have some real materials. But for now, I'm going to turn this up to 35% and see if I can disrupt this code.
All right. Are you making another attempt, Daniel?
Okay.
Assess the situation for me.
Assessing. Seven.
Noted. As you fiddle with it, you go to slip the ring off of your finger again. And before you're even able to get it completely clear of your flesh, you feel the beginning of that pain, that circuit breaking. You know pain is coming. And whatever you're trying to do, I don't think it worked.
Okay, nope, definitely not. That's not, nope, maybe not. Okay, can this go to double the output? Let's say, one second. Okay, maybe if I can weld these two pieces together. I'm going to roll to unleash my powers to try to attach some of these wires here that look like they have some carbon in it.
Okay. Go ahead and unleash your powers with advantage.
Nine.
With a nine, it takes a lot of skill. You've had so much practice working in the micro, but you get it. You're able to process and move tiny amounts of highly refined earth at a time. You move the carbon filaments. Something looks different. You can't quite see what it is, but it feels different. You've done something to this.
Okay, twisty right there. Yep, the red wire. No, okay, fine, the green one's fine. Yeah, no, stop. Okay, there we go. Okay, that should bring it up to 85%. Let's try this again.
Are you making another test, Daniel?
Yes.
I would like you to roll to directly engage a threat.
Okay. 6.
A 6. Interesting. Mark potential. And you go to move the ring. And nothing happens. You pull it off. There's no pain. The circuit is broken. This feels like a success. But with a 6.
Screw you, Frida.
Somewhere miles away, a notice pings on a small, dark screen. It's seen. A message is sent. A call to action. A cell activated. But you did it. The ring's off.
All right. All right, mark this. 85%. Great. Now, just gonna have to seal this all up again. I'm going to try to activate my powers again to put away this little makeshift earth lock I created.
Absolutely.
I'm going to roll to...
Roll plus freak to unleash your powers.
All right. 7.
With the 7, that's a hit. It should work. Nothing happens, Daniel.
Okay. Sorry, I just did it. Did this last time. Okay, here we go. Woo! Woo! Me, ma, mo.
Roll to unleash your powers with advantage.
Eight.
Should work. Nothing happens.
What is going on? No. Okay. This is cool. Maybe I just need a... I've been working for a lot of hours this week, so maybe I just gotta clear my head. You know, it's like Kiki's Delivery Service. You know, we don't always have magic all the time. We can just chill out, relax. Yeah. Whew. Okay. No issue.
Daniel, I would like you to mark the condition insecure. Please assess the situation for me.
Whew. 11.
With an 11, if you would like to ask any other questions, you can. But the first thing, the most important thing that I will note for you is you feel, even though you've worn this ring for what? A month? If that? Your finger feels naked without it. And you feel your stomach drop as you notice it in the midst of your panic.
Is there anything on the ring that I haven't noticed before?
Actually, after you attached some of those filaments, you are more aware of the wiring on the inside of this ring, things that you didn't notice when you first put it on, and it felt so good, so right to have it on that you didn't take it off to shower, you didn't take it off to sleep. It was that one sense of control, and now free of it, you see that the circuits that line on the inside of it glow with a strange green aura.
No, this is all in my head. That can't be.
And Daniel, with the roll that high, I will add that you hear footsteps coming down the hall.
I start trying to hurry up, putting away all these devices, but it's a lot harder now that I usually use some of my earth manipulation to seal everything up. Oh my god, oh my god.
As you get the last bits away, Fee, you return to the room, rebuffed once again by your friends.
Daniel, I just... is too many times to call someone and knock on their door? I just want to make sure Mara and Charlie are okay and that they're not answering. And I, wait, what is all this? Are you working on a lava lamp?
No, yes. You know, I remember that, the lava lamp that, Freddie dropped by, the battery went out. So I wanted to try to just like fix it a little bit. And, you know,
the one
I'm actually
that's
missing...
right there that's lit up and the battery isn't,
That's temporary. That is temporary. I replaced it for a second, but I have to get actually more parts. So I got to actually
I'll go with you. I can help you. We can do this.
No, Fee, I think it's... you don't have to go with me. It's fine. I could handle it on my own. Hey, cool. You know, maybe there's a chance Mara doesn't really, you know, need help right now. I think she might be going through some stuff on her own. And sometimes people just need to do things on their own, even though they have a lot of close friends around who want to help, they just need to figure things out for themselves. And
how much time do they need? Because I feel like I'm trying to give people space, and I know like sometimes people need space from their friends, but I don't want to sound selfish, but you guys are all I have, and I just am trying to help. It's not good to do things alone. I've gone through this on my own, you know, on my own planet, and it just doesn't end well. If I'm your friend, then I'm here to help, right? Like, I'm having a tough time understanding this process.
You know,
it feels very lonely.
I think you're right. It does not end well a lot. So rather than push everyone under the bus, which is a metaphor.
I know that one. It's not, you're not going to drive them.
Yeah.
I know that one.
This sometimes I would say that this school here can be a giant bus. And sometimes it's better for one person to jump in front of it so the other people don't have to.
So I should go.
I'm not making sense here. I'm sorry.
In front of a bus? You want me to do that to save our friendship?
Speaking of buses.
I'll do that for you, Daniel, and Mara, and Charlie. I will jump in front of a bus that is the school in this metaphor that you are speaking.
No, Fee, listen to me. I'm fine. I don't need your help right now. I think I can handle this on my own. There's just too many things that can go wrong, and I have to go. I have to actually catch the bus. So I will see you later.
Okay.
And with that, okay. Daniel leaves the room, and Fee, you're left alone again. And there's something so hard about that. Fee, everyone's pulled away. They're lost, but you've been lost too. You know better than most how important it is to stick together when things get rough. How are you feeling right now?
I'm feeling like how I did when I first came to this planet. And I fell through that portal. I got ripped away from my family and my planet. And now this is an all too familiar feeling. I'm not sure what portal I fell through that has ripped me away from my friends and put me in such a lonely place. But I wish there was a solution. I wish I was enough for them to... wish I was enough to make things better. And I just don't know how to fix this because humans are so complicated. If we could just have a discussion and talk about it, then, you know, we could work on it together. No one wants to do that. I almost feel like I'm the problem. And I am trying to fight this thought of maybe they're better off without me. I know that's not the truth. And I know I need to stay strong for them and see this through. But it hurts. And I don't have anybody. And I wish I did.
Fee, can you take a condition for me? Your choice.
I'm gonna do hopeless.
Yeah. Hopeless is the condition you've marked, but it's so final. It's not quite right. Fee, you are sad. You're more alone than you've been maybe any other day of your life. But you're not hopeless, not completely.
You're right.
You're worried, but you're not helpless. This hurts, but you are so strong.
Yeah.
You refuse to give up. You are so many things for so many people. You are a princess, a leader in training where you come from. And all of that training comes to bear here. You need to hold them together. So you get up again. You try again. Fee, you stand and you leave. And you shut the door behind you as you leave the dorm room, heading off to help your friends because they need you now more than ever.
You got this, Fiorkai. Don't take no for an answer and get to the bottom of it. Lay on the warmth. Warm them up with the heat bird. Wait, what did it do? The fire? Heat them up! Let's go, girl!
Now's actually not a good time. I'm kind of busy.
Busy? Charlie, you're never busy.
What do you mean? I could be busy.
I don't think so.
Fee!
What is going on? What's happening to our strongly established friendship group? I get it from Mara. She's been leashed and that's freaking her out. And Daniel's in his own world, talking to himself a little more than he usually does.
Fee.
No, you're busy.
Fee.
I'm not stupid, Charlie. I know you're hiding something. And I know you like to mess with me, but just for once, can you tell me the truth?
Okay. The truth is, I'm really worried, Fee. We got in a lot of trouble. We always knew we weren't supposed to hang out so much, and I'm not one to usually follow the rules, but now, if I get caught with any of this stuff, I'm in way more trouble than you know.
Trouble's never scared you, Charlie. You run towards trouble. And according to you, that's why you skip leg day. So if you're in trouble, wouldn't it be better to have your friends with you?
But if I go down...
Then we go down together. And I'll bring an extra sweater in case wherever down there is cold.
Okay, let's not get crazy. Look, I love you. It'll be okay. But if I get in any trouble, you will be the first to know, Fee. You're very persuasive, you know.
Persuasive?
Yeah, it means if somebody lets you down, they're gonna know there's gonna be hell to pay.
Like Satan.
My will is my own. My future is my own. My truth is my own. My will is my own. My future is my own. My truth is my own. My will is my own. Emma, if you keep forgetting your keys, I'm...
Hi!
Oh, what are you... Is something happening again?
No. Oh, well, yes. Things are always happening. But I think you mean, are any dangerous things happening? In that case, no.
Great, okay. Well, I kind of need some... Oh, my fee.
Listen, you haven't been answering your messages, so... I thought I would come and check on you myself.
Consider myself checked on. I really appreciate what you're doing, Fee, but I promise I'm okay.
Are you?
Fine. I'm not okay. I'm dealing with a lot, but not really something that you can help me with.
But do friends, don't they help each other? Don't they care about each other? Don't friends sometimes let friends love them?
I'm really sorry, but I think I need to handle this on my own.
Why though?
Because we messed up really bad, Fee. When we went to the rift, we almost died, and the only reason that we got through that was because we had powers. But I don't anymore. The next time we make a mess, I'm not going to be able to clean it up.
But you have me. I'll help clean it.
Fine, but only if we make small messes from now on.
Yeah. No more lion-sized messes. Promise.
Pinky promise?
Oh. Charlie told me about pinky promises. It's when you cut off your finger to show how serious you are in your promise.
Fee, you've really got to stop blindly believing Charlie about things. It's way more symbolic than that. Just link your finger with mine. And then touch your thumb. See how we've made a circle?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of showing that we can't break our promise.
Okay. So we stay like this until the promise is fulfilled.
Like I said, it's a little more symbolic. We don't have to keep holding hands.
Oh, yeah, of course. Cool.
Thank you for coming over, but I really do need to be alone now.
Okay, but I'll be here if you need me.
My will is my own. My future is my own. My truth is my own. My truth is my own. My future is my own. My will is my own. My truth is my own. My future is my own.
And I obey. My will is not my own. My future is my own. My truth is my own. My will is not my own.
What was that? Thunder.
Mara, you stand in the waiting room outside the Elder Council's chambers. The receptionist has blown you off, and he's eyeing you strangely. You are dizzy, pale, recovering from a headache is the closest word that you have for now. Pushing through the leash is possible for you, but there's a cost. A sort of leash hangover from tapping into your powers. And you barely remember leaving the dorms, leaving the campus, taking the bus across town to go seek counsel with the Supreme Mage Elder himself. You obsess about your vision of the hunter. I would love it if you assess the situation for me as you try to puzzle out exactly what you saw, exactly what it means.
I got a 9.
The 9? You think about it more and more, those words in a sort of vicious echo of what you remembered when you unleashed yourself from that tether. And you know that there is something holding her, something binding her. If her will isn't her own, whose is it? If her future isn't her own, whose is it? And that who at the center of the mystery of the hunter has sent you here. Because she's doing something for someone. She's controlled, operated by someone. But who? You may not know that, but you know that the most important thing you can do in this moment is alert the proper authorities. It's what you've been taught to do your whole life. And as you're lost in thought, you don't even notice when the Supreme Mage Elder peeks out of his room to yell something, a need, a whim of his towards the receptionist, and he spots you, Mara, pacing frenetically across the receptionist area. And he calls out your name and calls it out again till finally your intention is snapped from this reverie and you see him. And he's gesturing at you frantically to come inside his private chambers to talk. Miss Greer, sit, are you okay? Do you need water?
No, I'm fine. Is this the leash? Is it like, can sometimes powers break through it?
You see a bunch of expressions cross his eyes, pale purple eyes, in a flash. Please roll Pierce the Mask for me.
I got a 5.
Well,
a plus 3.
You do.
I like to use one.
Okay. With an 8. Yeah, you see concern and disbelief, wounded pride, and then curiosity, and then fear, until it resolves back into that calm mask of control that he wears at all times. It isn't unheard of that people could, with tremendous effort and training, break through their leashes. Why?
I guess I'm just wondering because even though you gave me the leash, I had a vision earlier. I wanted to come tell you, not because it happened, but because of what it was.
Why don't you tell me what happened, and I will figure out how best to go about this.
I saw the hunter, and I have reason to believe that the hunter is not on the rift side that the hunter doesn't have the Rift's best interests at heart. Like, it seems maybe since the hunter's always out in the human world grabbing kids that unleash their powers, maybe the humans got to her. And I don't know, I just...
Do you have...
It's scary.
Did you see something more concrete? Did you see her being taken, tampered with, replaced?
No, but I heard her.
Heard her?
She was saying that she's not in control of herself.
Okay. All right. I see what this is. Look, I'm not going to tell anyone that you've managed to break your leash. I put that on you myself, and there is no one on this side of the rift or anywhere else that could have done a better job. So if that was a real vision, we would have other problems.
If? Are you telling me that you don't think that I know what visions feel like? I'm trying to tell you that the rift is in danger.
By what? A person who says that she's not under her control? What can I do with that, Mara?
Look into it. You're on the Elder Council, you can do everything.
Yeah, if I go and look into it, then we have to have a conversation about tightening your leash. And I think that's a conversation that you don't necessarily want to have. You
understand? I'm being punished once again for trying to protect the rift, once again. Is that what you're saying?
You're not being punished. I'm simply offering that being a young mage, it can be difficult to know the difference between a vision, which is a rare ability, and a dream. Look, the things that you can do appear once in a generation. And learning that kind of control takes even more time. So I, as the Supreme Mage Elder, understand better than anyone else that you might not always know what you're seeing or what you're dealing with, but I appreciate that you came here to talk to me, to let me know. He looks incredibly condescending at you, and you see a flicker of something behind his eyes, something deeper than this veneer of dismissal. But Mara, it is a dismissal, and he relaxes back into the chair.
Yeah, you're right. I must have been dreaming.
It's totally understandable. Happens to the best of us. So why don't you head back to the dorm, and I'll keep an eye on the hunter.
Cool. Good. I'll let you know if I dream of anything else.
Did you really break through the leash?
Walk out of the room.
And he looks stymied as you turn and leave. And he's lost in thought as you move back through the council, downstairs, towards the front doors, but you pull out your phone and send a text. And we leave that scene and we move back across campus to Riftside Academy, just outside the gym of Riftside High, where the elementals have just completed their gym class. Now it's important to note that the elementals have their own gym class, and it's different than the physicals. It's different than the mages. The school has cracked down even more. So with the exception of non-powered interdisciplinary classes like math and science, history, English, you are kept away from each other. And Fee and Daniel are heading back to their class together, back to their dorms together after a pretty rough afternoon.
You doing okay?
Yeah, I just had to get back in the swing of things. Rough class, right?
Yeah. It seemed like you were having a really tough time with your powers.
I mean, you know, I just, I think I have a lot on my mind, you know, I just didn't have, a lot of rest this week, and,
yeah.
You know, how about you? I like that new ice spear move you did.
Thanks.
Fee.
That was cool.
Fee, I want you to pierce the mask on Daniel right now.
Okay.
Roll 2d6 plus your mundane.
7.
7's pretty good. Do you want to use a plus 3?
Yeah.
Make that a 10. With a 10, you can ask 3 questions. Any questions you like, Daniel will answer above game as you try to figure out what's really going on with him. This is more than a sleepless night.
Let's see. Why was Daniel having trouble using his powers during... it just seemed like... I'm trying to like figure out the direct question for this. Because he was definitely off.
Well, I'll offer something, even though normally this would be Daniel's opportunity to answer.
Yeah, yeah.
As you try to figure out, like, what really is it? It's not just that you're tired. He is absently fussing with that ring that you've always seen on him.
And it's not on him right now?
Oh, it's on, but he keeps wiggling it, shaking it. He's just playing with his hand a lot.
And also to answer your question, I wish I knew, but I know that there's something really, really wrong, and I'm scared about it.
If you want to hold the rest of your questions as this conversation continues, you can absolutely do that.
Okay, yeah, I'll do that.
Go ahead.
Is your ring okay, Daniel? Keep like holding it. I wonder if it's like broken. Do you want me to take a look at it? On my planet, we're really good with the tech stuff, so you know, maybe I can, I don't know, fix it if it's like, you know, giving you issues. It's a little pokey.
Fee,
it's like
I've been really honest with you this past few weeks with all our friends, Charlie and Mara, just like we haven't been talking, and I don't know. I don't want to say. I don't know if I should say this because bad things happened last time we disobeyed the rules, and I want to protect you. Okay, I just don't want you to be involved. But I don't know. I don't feel like I could handle this to my own, and I'm honestly. I'm a little scared about what's going on with me.
Is this what they talked about in health class? Puberty?
Oh.
Is that... Because I heard that's very normal for humans. So if there are changes happening...
Fee...
I think it's completely normal, Daniel. You're growing into your body, and it's changing.
You know...
That would make sense, because you were all over the place in gym. I was like, yikes, does he even know how to use his legs? I don't know. Don't be ashamed.
It's not necessarily that. It's
Fee, I need you to clear a condition.
eye clear condition?
No, Fee does.
Oh, okay.
She said a helpful thing.
Okay.
It's not that.
If it's not that, then I'm sorry. Oh, what is it?
I need help, and
I could help. I'm good at helping. I'll listen now.
Remember when I first came here and the whole corn incident?
Yeah. So funny.
Well, that wasn't what I actually was trying to say. I was trying to say that I was in quarantine. Quarantine. Oh my god, see, I'm even saying it again. Quarantine.
That happened to me when I first got here. But it was because I was an alien. And I didn't know how to communicate or speak the language.
Okay.
Wait, why would they do that to you? If you're a student, they shouldn't put you in quarantine.
Did they... How long did they keep you there?
Until I was able to learn the language. It was... I don't even know.
Fee, you have to promise me... Can you promise to keep what I'm about to tell you a secret? Remember those pinky promises that Charlie taught you?
Yeah, but that's like a pinky promise, like in good faith, not to like to do things. You want me to keep a secret?
Well, sometimes trust is a really important thing that we have as humans, and I think I just need to trust you. Before I tell you this,
I understand. You can trust me. I'll keep your secret.
And before your pinkies can meet, Fee, your phone rings. It's been a long time since your phone has ringed. And you see that there's a text message from Mara that says, "Meet me at the council building as quickly as you can. We need to talk. I saw something."
Daniel, I'm so sorry. I think Mara needs us.
What did she say?
We need to go meet her right now. Can you... I will keep this promise and whatever secret you're about to tell me, but I haven't heard from Mara in what feels like forever.
No, yeah.
Do you mind if we go check on her and see if she's all right?
Yeah. If she's in trouble, let's go.
Okay. I text Mara back that I'm on my way.
And we follow that text message across the rift to Mara, who sent that message to both Fee and Charlie. And she looks up, and as she's sort of waiting in this beautiful, lush, green garden with a massive, shallow pool, beautiful sculptural marble pieces and water features, a display, if there ever was one, of power and wealth and privilege. Please assess the situation for me, Mara.
I got 4.
Oh, that's beautiful. I love it.
Wait, we have some plus 30s though,
no, right? No, I don't think so. That doesn't sound right. Nah. Why don't you just go ahead and mark potential for me?
Got it.
And you look back down again to see responses in the affirmative that both Charlie and Fee are on their way. And you miss a little hint of the hunter in her browns, that little bit of pink, dusty bangs, clocks you and then slips behind a bush. Nothing's amiss, and 10 minutes later, Charlie, Fee, and Daniel arrive at the scene.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
Hey. What's going on?
Don't tell anyone. I had a vision, even though I have a leash on, and there's something going on.
But you had a vision.
You're able to use your powers?
How's that possible?
I think I got through.
You broke the rules?
Nice. Okay, don't say that so loudly.
No.
Look, I remembered the thing that they would always chant when they took my dad's leash off. And so I tried it in my dorm room, and when I did that, I had a vision. I think there's something really dangerous happening here. And I think it has to do with the hunter. The elder doesn't want to listen to me.
Wait, sorry. The hunter, you said?
Yes. Why? Do you know? You do. She brought you in, didn't she? She did.
What happened in this vision with the hunter exactly?
She was saying that she's not in control of herself.
Mara, as you speak, you are suddenly cut off. As all of the air leaves your lungs, I am using my first hard move. As you are bum-rushed by the hunter who's been lying in wait behind the bushes. Please take the condition, afraid, as she knocks you off your feet and tackles you to the ground. And she looks up at all of you, snarling. Her eyes don't even seem to really focus on you. They flit so fast you can barely see the color of her eyes. She goes from Daniel to Mara below her to Charlie to Fee, feral, angry. She growls and is gonna run at Charlie. It's time for a fight, y'all. What do you want to do?
I'm gonna let her. Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead. She's running at you.
She's running at me. I was just gonna let her go through me. I don't know if she knows what I can do yet, but I'm gonna not move and just let her go.
Just gonna let her. All right. So she runs at you, and she stops just in front of you, and you see her hand begin to vibrate, and it blurs, and it looks weirdly like you do when you're phasing. She's moving incredibly fast, Charlie, and she swings at you. And if you're not gonna stop it, she lands the hit. Please take a condition for me.
Oh my, okay.
You get knocked off your feet and sent 10 meters back, ripping up dirt and grass behind you.
Right before Charlie falls on the ground, I unleash my powers and make the patch of dirt that she's around softer.
Okay.
What?
Please roll to unleash your powers for me.
Seven.
Yeah, with a seven, you're able to... Oh, why don't you tell me what it looks like?
Okay, so I see that Charlie's skidding back and about to lose balance. So I dig my arm into the dirt and I throw this mound towards her, and then the mound lands right behind her and then crumbles. So it's like a soft pillow.
Nice. All right, you don't take any additional damage from the land. You just take it from the hit. Charlie, when's the last time that you've been hit?
It's been a very long time. I was prepared to face. She should not have been able to touch me.
And you realize something. You're so smart. You spent the last 2 weeks analyzing data, sensing patterns, realizing truths in the things that you see in front of you. And you see the gap. This is what a fully realized, fully grown, fully trained, unleashed looks like. And she knows what you can do. And she's not scared of you. She turns on her heels, slowly, and looks at you, Daniel. And a voice that comes out. You've heard her speak. I don't know if any of you have met the hunter before. Mara, you know her voice. You know what it's supposed to sound like. Daniel, what you hear is corrupted, garbled, as if it's like pushed through a microphone with the gain much too high. She says, someone He's been messing with something he shouldn't have. And as she turns her head to crack her neck audibly, preparing to move again, Daniel, please assess the situation for me.
I'm gonna... 12.
With a 12, as she moves, the scarf dips down a little bit, and you see dark lines moving up her neck. They look like veins blackened or circuits blackened as they crawl. And even though you've never seen that before, your hand sort of instinctually moves towards your chest.
Whoa, whoa, stop. Hey, you remember me? We met that night by the rift. Why are you attacking?
I remember you finding your way into the rift, getting locked in quarantine in prison for a month. And the only way you were let out was on the condition that you never, ever took that ring off. But I think it's come off, hasn't it, Daniel? That's a big no-no. Okay. And as you blink, she disappears from your vision, running fast, so fast she's a brown blur. And she's about to land a hit. Who wants to do something?
Can I roll for burn?
Yes, please.
I got a 10.
Now, I will say something. Let me just jump in. Rolling for burn, that summoning of your power is going to take just long enough that I might get a hit in. So what do you want to do?
I'll roll for to defend then.
Okay.
Can I do that instead?
Yeah, absolutely. Roll 2d6 plus your savior.
Okay, I got a 10.
Yeah. All right, you begin to summon those great wells of power within you, and then you see her disappear, and you see a brown streak headed towards Daniel, and you stop the summoning in order to do what? To protect Daniel.
Am I able to... I'm not able to use my... powers at all?
Yes. Yeah. You're absolutely able to use your powers. It's just not. Okay. Yeah. It's just not your like burn level abilities.
Okay. I want to like send an ice wall in front of Daniel to hopefully give him a second to step back or protect himself from what's coming his way.
Her entire body slams into it, and as quickly as you summon it, it is reduced to snowy dust around you. Daniel, you are essentially hit with the biggest snowball you've ever felt. But better a snowball than the hunter. You've successfully defended.
Daniel, you gotta get out of there. Guys, do we have to fight this lady? What is happening?
We have to be really careful. She's
You
strong.
Can try. Yeah.
Yes. Charlie, she's a physical, right?
Yeah.
All right, what's...
And a very powerful one.
And she's a speedster? What's the weakness with a speedster physical?
I don't know.
It's a mage, isn't it? Awesome.
Oh, a mage. Okay. And she's gonna turn, and she picks up a big shard of ice and is gonna fling it at Mara. Mara, what do you do? It's coming straight for your face, baby girl.
Oh. I would like to... Oof. Can I... I can't just, like, step out of the way, can I?
You could try.
I don't like that. I'd like to just throw up a hand and have a very, very small barrier come up. It hurts to use my powers, so I'm just gonna put up the smallest barrier to protect myself.
For what it's worth, especially in moments of great stress and duress, that pain, it's accretive. Like, it builds up over time, and it's just annoying for now, and the adrenaline's surging through you. You're not going to feel this yet.
Okay.
I don't want you to feel restrained.
Okay.
You have access to your powers.
Perfect. Then I would like to instead use my signature chains that I whip out of my hands. But I'd like to whip one out, wrap it around the ice shard, and then fling it right back at her.
Oh. I would love it. Love, love, love it. If you roll to directly engage a threat.
Ooh, double sixes.
Beautiful.
That's a 13 for me.
Nice. Yeah, so you fling this back at her. And you literally see her turn into it, and she lets it shatter. She bleeds. Normal blood. You don't know what you're expecting. And she looks down. Okay. You got one shot in. Now this feels fair. And with another blink, she seems to disappear from your view. And she makes a move for Fee. Fee, I would like you to roll to take a powerful blow.
Oh.
She's gonna grab you by the throat, raise you into the air, and then slam you down.
I got a 12. Oh. So.
This is.
Oh no!
Like Christmas
oh, no.
for me.
No! No!
You have, I'm gonna say two options, because you're not gonna pick two options from the 7 to 9 list. What would you like to do? Fee, you've gone through so much. Mm-hmm. You've gone through so much the last couple weeks. All of that anxiety, all of that tension, all of those emotional conditions that have been inflicted on you all the time. And you just want to protect them. And you were just trying to help. And then in this moment, you take a hit bigger than you have ever taken before. And as your body slams into the ground, all of the dew across this lawn, all of the water inside that shallow pool, all of the water creatures, they shoot up 10 feet in the air and freeze, bright pink, glowing. Just like your eyes right now, Firakai, as you feel yourself more connected to all of the strange water of this world than it ever has been before, but you cannot control it. It crystallizes, turns into shards, gets scattered in every direction.
No!
And everyone but you is gonna take a condition, your choice, as you are all pelted, assaulted with water. It rips up the hunter too. She's not immune, but this is your truth, Fee. You are a Nova. And when you lose control, it goes bad for everyone. The ground is ripped up. You can hear the shattering of marble. The water in the pool, once it comes back down and everything unfreezes, begins to drain away deep into the earth from this rent pool. There's devastation everywhere.
I'm so sorry. I lost control of my powers. I don't.
Fee, it's okay.
Fee, yeah. Are you all right?
You don't have time to comfort her right now. We're doing this. And I'm not done yet. Who wants to go?
Mara's gonna go. We have to be a step ahead of her. She's too fast.
Can you see ahead?
I'm gonna try. And I'd like to use my powers to see the next few minutes in the future, or not minutes, seconds in the future, to see where she's going to go so I can warn whoever she's going to attack.
Amazing. So does this ability come with a roll?
Well, it depends if I use my stick to the mission ability when I defend someone critically important to the future. That wouldn't really actually work. No, I think I do have 21st century studies. So if I assess the situation, I can ask what the future knows about this moment.
Absolutely. Please do.
Perfect. I got a 9.
Yeah. With a 9, your mind seems to like blink out and you are pushed into an aerial view of the situation. And you see this entire fight happening in real time, and then it begins to speed up just a little bit. Now you're ahead of the fight by maybe 3 seconds, but at the speed she's moving, 3 seconds is a lifetime. She's gonna hit Daniel next. And for the rest of this encounter, as long as you are using this power, and don't you forget, there will be a cost, you will have a +1 to your roll. And if you're able to adequately warn someone before something happens, they'll have a +1 forward. As you watch, as your view returns to where you're standing, and you see two worlds, the one happening in real time, and a ghost laid on top of it, of what's going to happen. You have both.
Am I
still have an action?
I would like to use my astral projection to cast my voice over to Daniel. I don't think I'm standing directly next to him, but I'd like to use my voice in like a whisper in this way, yeah, so that she doesn't hear me warning my friends.
Yep.
And in that
moment,
I'm
not gonna make you roll for that. You can do that.
Okay, perfect. Daniel, she's gonna hit you next. Get ready.
How are you doing? Okay. V.
Yeah.
You know how you can make water turn to ice? That means you do cool things, right?
Are you spending time talking right now?
Daniel, now!
Okay, can
she
you-
She disappears you from
to,
view.
You have to freeze her. You have to freeze her right now. She's a speedster.
Daniel, I'm gonna need you to take a powerful blow. You only have 3 seconds.
Can I intercept and defend?
Yeah, what do you want to do?
Woo! I would like to phase into the ground and be under Daniel's feet to pull him under when she comes for him.
Okay. I want you to roll to directly engage a threat with disadvantage, because she's moving faster than you can right now.
Okay.
And you didn't hear the warning, so you have to react to her.
Right. I rolled a 9.
Okay. You have rerolls. Or you have +3s if you want to turn that 9 into a 12.
I would actually love to do that with this one.
Yeah. Good call. Once again, you are a master at putting together the pieces. And you didn't have to hear Mara to know what was coming. She has attacked each of you in turn. And the only one that hasn't really taken a hit off of her yet is Daniel. So you slip into the ground, are you moving under her to try to pull her down?
I was gonna pull Daniel.
Oh, you're gonna pull Daniel down. Oh yeah, that's much easier to do. You absolutely do that. Daniel, you are pulled under the earth, and I'm assuming still phased, so you're not currently crushed by the ground around you.
Yeah, definitely phased.
All right.
And as I'm being pulled down, I see all the crushed marble that was just destroyed from all the little sculptures around the quad that Fee destroyed.
On accident.
On accident, don't worry. And then as that's happening, I start tapping them.
All right. Are you just unleashing your powers?
Or
are you rolling for burn?
I am tapping them and doing something with them.
Okay, I love secrets. Sure. Do you want to explain to the class what you're doing? I'll let you do it. I just don't know what's happening.
I am tapping them and they are all floating upwards.
Okay, so you move through the ground, reach your hand up. Charlie, you're gonna have to go with him because he can't make physical contact with any of this.
Sure.
Unless you like are holding on to him and allowing him to selectively phase back.
All right, I'll stick with him.
Okay, they all begin to drift upwards. The hunter pauses, looking around, looking down at where she thinks you still are. And you can hear her, you're a couple meters away now, as she laughs and goes, I can still get you down there. and she immediately drops to all fours and starts ripping up the ground. She's trying to dig for you.
Can I roll for burn?
Yet? Yeah, absolutely. Please do. Okay.
I got a 10.
Nice. And hold three.
I heard what Daniel had said to me. Correct?
Yeah, you heard it because it was him spending his time that allowed him to almost get hit.
With that, I want to react very quickly and use Reality Storm to freeze the hunter.
Freeze the hunter?
Yes. Try and freeze the hunter from moving so quickly?
Okay, are you trying to freeze the blood inside her body or use ice to stop her? Let's be very clear about what
you're
Fee's trying to do
I'm
in this moment.
I'm about to kill somebody if he doesn't just figure it out for a second.
I just wanna know if you're becoming a bloodbender or something. You know, that's wild.
Okay, so with Reality Storm, it's a destructive burst of my powers.
Yeah.
I would like to kind of do this cool little bit of a windmill wushu move and smack my hand to the ground. And with that, send this stream of ice straight towards the hunter and have it encompass all of her like a jail cell where she can't move or get out of. And I want it to be really thick ice. Reality Storm is supposed to be a super big destructive burst. And I imagine as the ice heads towards her, it can kind of explode in that way and encapsulate her at its center. And maybe that will just buy us a bit of time.
Okay. Are you spending a second burn?
Yes, I am.
All right. So you summon this massive wave of ice and it streaks at her as she's digging into the ground and crests like a wave and drops over her like a massive claw. Now you can encapsulate her, but this doesn't do damage. But you hear her groan and start to throw her body against both sides of this as she begins the process of trying to break herself out. But she's stuck for now.
What do we do? We have to knock her out. We can't kill her.
No.
I almost killed her.
We have to be a step ahead of her. I can try to warn you guys when she's gonna hit. She moves too fast.
Fee, but that's good, Fee. You put her in there right now. So we have one move that we can spend on her right now. So I'm going to shift all of the marble that I just lifted into the air right above the cage, and I'm charging it up ready to slam it all down as soon as she breaks out of the cage.
You're gonna wait?
I'm gonna wait as soon as she breaks out of it, the ice cage.
Okay, do me a favor, assess the situation for me with disadvantage because your attention is being taken by, summoning all of this marble.
May I look forward to see what her next moves are?
I would love it if you did so. Just make an assess for me. You'll always be able to do it. You've unlocked this ability. It's just how good it is in this moment.
Great, I rolled a 7 plus 1. 2, because I get a plus 1 from Sticks and Mission. So that's a 9, sorry.
Nice. With a 9, you feel your vision sort of push forward, and you see her looking up, throwing herself against it. You see that this ice is colder than normal, and every time she throws her body against it, you actually see frostbite going across her shoulders, and eventually, she will take enough damage that she gives up and begins to dig down. She's not going to break out of it. She's going to go below.
Mara, can you tell me which direction she's going to come out of?
The floor isn't contained. She's going to go in the earth. Charlie, Daniel, can one of you do something?
I can definitely get her from under the ground.
She's going to start digging now. Go.
Okay.
Okay.
Maybe Charlie, if you can hold her feet while you're underneath there, and then I can throw the marble right down on her so she can't go.
I'm going to try and throw her out of the ground, and I want to just dive into the ground.
Okay, do that.
Go ahead and roll Unleash Your Powers for me, please, and thank you.
Woo-hoo. I rolled a 10.
Nice. Describe for me what you do.
So, is she already dug down, or we know that she's about to start doing that?
The amount of time it took you guys to talk, like I said, Mara's got a 3-second heads up.
Right.
She's already probably 5 or 6 feet below this ice cage. By the way, you can kind of see it down here. Mm-hmm. It is impressive. The walls of this are like 4 feet thick. Fee has put some serious elemental work into holding her. And the hunter was able to dig down through the weakest point where all of the water reconverged under her. And shattering that, she's digging down. But she's unaware of you. How could she see you? She's okay. Blind, digging through the dark.
I know what I would like to do. I would like to run on the surface until I'm above where she is under the ground and then dive straight down at her.
Well, if you go up to the surface, you're no longer going to be able to see where she is because you can't see through the dirt. So you can go to where you think she is.
All right, I'm going to dive from the surface, but once I'm under, I want to like use my trajectory of falling through the ground to aim at her and go directly from above, zoom down at her, and then grab her feet to pull her and then throw her up.
Okay, I'm going to have you also roll to directly engage a threat here.
Okay.
Because now this is your brawn versus a adult physical who is strong.
Okay. May I use my ability?
I can't support her in any way.
You can't see what's happening right now.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. Okay.
I'd like to use my ability. Ooh. Punch everyone to move my danger up and another label down.
What are you going to move down?
Superior.
Mm-hmm.
And then rolling to engage a threat. I rolled a 12 plus 3. That's 15.
All right. So you go and it is the element of surprise that gets her. She's moving so fast, and you're very good at physics. It's about acceleration. You're able to leverage her. You phase her and throw her up. She can't use any of her mass against you because she doesn't have it anymore. And you throw her up above. Daniel, she's about 15 feet away from the point at which you were aiming. What do you want to do?
Okay, so I'm going to shoot all the marble directly at her in the air because in the air, she can't run, right? So she's an easier target.
Go ahead. Roll to directly engage a threat for me.
Eight.
Okay. You can either take a condition so this goes the way you want. Or actually, no, that's not how directly engage a threat works. Go ahead and pick one from the list for me.
Condition?
No, pick one from the directly engage a threat list.
Oh, got it. Surprise the opposition.
Yeah. She's up in the air and you see her kind of like arms open as she's trying to like right herself being thrown at this like kind of wild angle by Charlie, completely unexpected. And she turns just in time to see a wall of shattered marble coming at her. And she is, in fact, surprised. But surprise doesn't mean not ready. She's always ready, and you didn't pick resist or avoid her blows. And now that she has mass again,
crap.
She will take some of that, but she's gonna send some of it right on back. As the first big piece hits her, dead in the torso, you hear a wet sound, and she pulls it out and flings it down at you. Daniel, please take 2 conditions for me. As you get hit with a piece of marble too. And as she slams into the ground and is buried under this pile of rubble, you're unsure if she's going to get up from this or not.
Two conditions or one condition?
Two conditions.
Two conditions.
Can I
Angry this is part of guilty. His move. You can't intercept.
Okay, got it.
Angry and guilty.
Perfect. All right. But Daniel's visible now, Fee, and you see the pile of rubble where the hunter is. What would you like to do?
The hunter is under the rubble, or can I see her? Amidst it.
Just roll plus superior for me. It's not a full assess, but we're just going to describe what it looks like based on how you roll.
8.
Yeah. With an 8? Yeah. I'm going to say that... Do you want to be able to see her?
Yeah.
I assume so. You're able to see a hand, and you see it immediately kind of grabbing at rocks and crushing them. Okay. And beginning to, like, work its way, like, out of... from under this pile.
Okay. I'd like to run over, and I want to, like, knock her the heck out with an ice fist. To her face.
Ice fist. Always with the ice fist. You don't see her face. There's rubble in the way. But if you get an assist from a friend who can see 3 seconds in the future, maybe you'll get a clear shot.
Okay.
Mara!
I gotta punch someone. Where are they gonna be?
I would love to see... am I able to look into possible futures, not just the one that's about to happen, but see like a couple at a time?
Ooh.
And able to see what the best possible way to knock someone out is.
That's super cute. I love that a ton. Let's make that an assess roll. Roll plus superior. I'm gonna say roll with disadvantage, just because that's cool, but hard.
Okay, I got a 4 and a 2, 6 plus 1. Do I get my plus 2 on this?
No, because this is not directly related into you seeing 3 seconds in the future.
Okay. And a plus. So, a 6.
You could take a plus 3.
I could take a plus 3, couldn't I?
You absolutely could. But I think you're at, I think you said you were at a 7, yeah?
I'm
so
at
plus 3 would be a 10.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd like that.
That look. If I'm wrong, say something now. If I go back and check the tape.
That is correct. I would be at 10.
Yeah, absolutely. Go ahead and use one of those plus 3s.
Perfect.
And yeah, you are literally frozen in time. All of you see as Mara stops, like hairs, as she like turns her head are frozen as she pushes through and moves through time on a bunch of different levels. And you see several futures in front of you. You see Daniel crushing the rocks down, but that won't quite do it. Mara could hit her with a fist. That isn't quite it. What are you looking for specifically? One of those visions will be exactly what you say now, the best way to finish this fight. What is it, Mara?
I'm looking for more power than I guess one of us would have. I'm looking for a future where Daniel and Fee and Charlie are all working together to knock out the hunter, like as a group, because she's unleashed and we're not, and it's gonna take more than one of us to knock her out or just end her, I guess. So I'd love to look for a future that has all three of us, or all four of us, participating at once, I guess.
Amazing. And Mara, something strange happens. You've been in this moment, and everything else has been very clear, very much like this day, but not this vision that you're pushing through. You are seeing beyond, not to what could be in this moment, but what could be if so many things from decades past were different. If the world knew, if the rift knew better than it knows now. And you see something that makes your heart stop. You see all of you working together, crossing your abilities, becoming more powerful, 100-fold more powerful than any of you individually. 100-fold more powerful than anyone the Rift has seen since it was built. And it's not destructive, it's controlled. And the four of you control it. And this fight isn't even a fight anymore. Because who could stand against all four of you when you work together? And the vision of it is something your brain can't even comprehend. You don't even know how to go about getting to that moment. But in this moment, Mara, you know that there is something strange. A mote of possibility. That what you have been told your entire life might not exactly be true. That there's something more that you could do. Something more that all of you could be. More than unleashed. And your vision snaps back. And now you see that both Daniel can apply extra pressure. Charlie can make sure that she doesn't dig down, keeping her locked in this moment by staying beneath it. And Fee sending in water to cement the rocks around, not crossing your powers, but working together will be enough to finish this fight. And as you come back to reality, you are shaken by the things that you've seen, Mara. Please take a condition.
Okay. Took insecure. I'd like to use the astral whispering that I was using earlier for all three of my friends. Yeah. Listen to me, no hesitation here. We all have to strike at once. Same thing we just did. Daniel, hit him hard. Charlie, hold her. And Fee, flutter. We have to do this now.
Got it.
Okay, got it.
Go.
I would like all three of you to roll to unleash your powers. Separately, you are not crossing your abilities. All of you know better than that. All of you have learned the lesson, but you have to act together as one right now. Anything lower than an 8 is gonna count as a miss for this, so roll high.
I got a 13.
Ooh. Charlie?
I rolled a four
too!
How many plus threes do they have?
I think there's two left.
Okay, so that gets you to a 7. And there's still two in the team pool. Oh!
Am I able to help them by helping them, giving them a plus one by giving them advice of like, no, not like that. You need to hit it this way.
Mara, if you coordinate, I'm gonna have you roll plus your superior. Same thing. Your threshold's an 8. If you roll an 8 or better, you can time this perfectly. Giving them the plus one they need to succeed. If you fail this roll, Mara, nothing exists to help you. You will fail, and you will all pay the price for it.
Am I?
Oh, no.
Did you tell me if I'm able to use a plus three or not?
There's no plus threes left.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Okay. I got a 6.
Ooh, a 6?
I got a 7.
But I got a 13!
Yeah, you're very good at this feat.
We can stall. Maybe a plus three
can be
found under couch cushion.
We're gonna stall for just a minute.
Maybe a plus three is like in the corner of a couch cushion or something.
To see if chat helps you out.
Let me check my pockets. Hold on.
Everyone check your pockets.
We are so close, Rifties. Please come through.
And Mara, as you try to time this out, your mind keeps flitting away to possible futures. You see the hunter, beyond unleashed, overclocked with power, her face entirely taken over with black, angular, circuit-like veins, her eyes gone completely to black and gold. She looks more machine than person. And if she emerges from this rubble, you know, you see it, the vision you know better than to ever share with anyone, she will kill you. All. And that's where your vision fades with her victory, because you can't see past that. You can't see the things that will come if she wins in this moment. But as your vision comes back to you, a plus 3 has appeared.
Yes, thank you, Rifties.
I got a 9.
And you coordinate perfectly. Each of you in turn will describe your piece of the action as you finish this fight. And we'll start with a 13. Fee, what do you do?
I'm supposed to cement her body down? What was the...
Yeah, you're supposed to flood this with water as she's trapped underneath, just to knock her out.
Okay.
So she can't move enough to, like, disrupt the rock.
This is the first time that Fee's probably done this in a fight. Her eyes will glow pink, and instead of usually having the water come from the way that, like, you know, humans kind of use it, like, out of the ground, I want it to come from the sky and just flush down on the hunter and bubble around her.
Nice. All right. You do your part. Charlie, what do you do?
My part is keeping her from going underground, so I want to be... I'm just below her, phased under the ground, and I want to grab her ankles, and I'm going to secure her that way. But I'm staying phased, so I don't get hurt.
Nice. And you've done this really weird thing where you're, like, partially phased, but you're able to grab onto her, so mm-hmm. she's partially phased. And you hear through the water rushing in, as if she's yelling at you through a pool. She says, I see you, Charlie King. And you may stop me, but you can't protect him. Daniel, what do you do?
Now that all the water's flushing down, I use it to more easily combine with the earth to make this kind of cement to grab hold of her and try to slam her down to knock her out.
Yep, you do so. You crush all this material down together, making it dense, smaller, more solid. She can't move. And Charlie, you feel, as she finally stops struggling, that intense strength that's almost too much for you to bear lessens. She's knocked out. And you wait a couple tense breaths. And then you exhale, and you are the first person to know that this is it. The fight is over, and the hunter is unconscious. And you look around as you reemerge from below the ground, and you see shattered ruins, ripped up trees and dirt, that beautiful, pristine green lawn, wreckage. Somewhere, a pipe burst that's sending a massive geyser of water into the sky. Something broke on the side that's kicking up thick, viscous, greasy black smoke. This is what it looks like to fight a fully realized unleashed. But the four of you did it. And as you stand here in the remains, panting, out of breath, you did it together. You won.
Whoa! How? How did we do that? I almost killed everyone.
We almost died.
Do we always have to destroy public property every time we see each other?
Wait, speaking of which, yeah. We should probably get out of here, right? No one saw us, maybe?
Yeah, we probably should until someone does.
Yeah, and your excitement is cut short as we leave you all sprinting away as best you can to find cover and recover.
On tonight's news, we have confirmation regarding the events that took place earlier today at Council Grounds. Reports came in from several sources that an explosion had occurred within the area. Witnesses claim to have seen water shooting skyward, followed by debris scattering across the grounds. Originally, there were rumors of a fight breaking out between several unidentified individuals, some suggesting that there were students involved, others stating that they came from outside the rift. However, these claims were completely disproven when it was revealed by the council that the council guard had been running routine drills involving elementals. This is the official statement released by the council addressing the situation. Today, our council scheduled several routine drills as part of their monthly training. This was a perfectly normal exercise to keep the elemental team at their best. There is no need for alarm. The spread of false rumors must be stopped immediately to avoid any unnecessary panic. We remind you that as long as we are within the rift, we are safe. The rift has protected us against darker forces for years, and it will remain that way for years to come. I think I can speak for myself and the listeners at home when I say that that statement clears up a lot of confusion and puts us all at ease. Next up on the news, a heartwarming tale straight from our senior center about a young man who uses his magical constructs to stage full productions of classic musicals. Let me tell you have not lived until you've seen several masses of pure magical essence dazzle their way through the Pirates of Penzance. You won't want to miss this. But first, a word from our sponsors. Stay frosty, Riffside.
So we pick up in the class, in school, at Riftside. You are all together in Algebra 2 because this is a school that makes sense. You are all young minds that still need normal subjects because even wizards need to learn math. And the teacher standing in front of you is Mrs. Oseni. She's Nigerian-American with dark skin, high cheekbones, and she wears a beautiful bright blue scarf around her neck over the white and khaki faculty uniform. And she is mid-drone about quadratic equations, completing the square, and is turning back and forth a ton to fill the board up even more with a bunch of polynomial math and just, you know, honestly, just algebraic nonsense. And this is an interdisciplinary class, so all three abilities are allowed to mix here. And the four of you are actually in close proximity with one another. It's the day after the hunter fight. No one really, really knows what happened there. And Mara looking pretty worse for wear with a sizable leash hangover is barely alive in one corner as the rest of you sit around, actively ignoring the math class.
Hey, Mara, you doing okay?
Not at all. This sucks. I might have overdone it during that fight.
Yeah, I can't believe you actually used your powers. I didn't think that was possible.
Yeah, well, there's a lot that's possible, Daniel.
Yeah. Well, it's good to see you guys again. I know last time we hung out is a bit rough. Well, two battles ago.
I think I'd say every time we hang out it's a bit rough. Well, at least since you got here, at least. I wonder if there's a coincidence there.
That's a little harsh.
Maybe Mara needs some ice cream so she can feel better.
No, I think I've had enough ice, especially after the other day.
That was an accident.
I do have a question though. So say you have a bunch of ice cream in your freezer at your dorm, and then everything's going fine. Months go by, nobody takes your ice cream, but then like someone shows up, and then your ice cream starts missing. Wouldn't you suspect that person?
What are you getting at?
Did you steal her ice cream, Daniel?
Roll plus danger as you speak just a little too loudly and Mrs. Oseni turns. What? What was that? Does someone have a question?
I got an 8.
Yeah, how much time is left?
What? There's a clock right there, Miss King. You have 10 minutes. Keep listening.
Okay, sorry, just checking.
So remember, foil, and she goes back to working at the board.
Sorry.
What?
One, Mara, I'm lactose intolerant. Two, I know what you're trying to say. I'm not dumb. I know these things just keep are happening. What first with the mountain lion and now with the
keep
the
your
hunter.
Voice down.
I swear this is not what it looks like, okay?
It's not even that, Daniel. Everything that the hunter said yesterday kind of doesn't help your point right now.
Well, but maybe his point is, maybe he's not ready to talk about his point. Mara, guys, you're being really rude. That probably was really hard for him. Did you ever think about that? Maybe it's not something he's ready to talk about.
Mara, what are you trying to get at? Are you trying to say? Do you think I'm purposely trying to hurt you guys?
Daniel, do me a favor and roll plus danger as some of the other mages sitting near Mara on the other side of her are starting to perk up to look over at this conversation that she's having.
Eight.
With an eight, like one of them leans over, Ransom, and kind of swats Mara, like, hey, you good? I know we have to be in these classes with like other classes, but do you need me to do something? Are they bothering you?
Ransom, of all people, I don't need you to do anything.
Okay, well, I was being nice. Anything to not actively do math, I would rather hex someone than I don't understand any of this. And he goes back to working.
Thanks, Ransom.
Mara, I don't know what you're getting at, but Daniel had our backs back there. And in the council chambers, he defended me. You didn't need to do that.
Right. And the hunter is supposed to be on our side, but I definitely don't think that they are anymore.
Mara, I'm trying to figure this out too. I admit, the hunter was singling me out, but I swear I don't know why she was doing that. I really don't know.
So, maybe you didn't hear it, but actually, Daniel, how long have you been in the Rift? I'm just curious.
I mean, I saw you guys my first day, that's all.
Okay. Oh, Mara, pierce the mask for me. With advantage.
Gonna be a good 6 plus 1, 7.
Okay, a 7's a hit. You know he's lying.
Right, so you've only been here 2 weeks. Got it. But why is it that the hunter says you've been here for longer?
I...
Are you bad at math too, Daniel? That's okay. Maybe he didn't count correctly, Mara. Maybe that's... I know you should probably
say something.
Oh yeah,
2 and 6 are definitely super easy to mix up.
Well, I'm sure he has a good explanation.
Yeah,
right,
yeah.
Daniel?
Charlie, roll plus danger with disadvantage.
Me?
Mm-hmm.
Disadvantage? 2.
Go ahead and mark potential.
Wait, plus danger? Sorry, that'd be a 5.
Yeah. It's go so ahead nice. And mark potential as you speak up in Daniel's defense and Mrs. Oseni turns around. Okay, I'm going to need you all to focus. This is super important and you can't be sitting around talking. So I'm not going to let any of you leave here until you all understand. And then the bell rings and you're all released from the class. She can't hold you here any longer. And this beginning interrogation is over. For now. And we move from there to a couple hours later at the end of the school day. And we'll begin where we do so often, in Fee and Daniel's dorm room, where at least the two of them can pick up the broken conversation of the last few days.
Just when I thought we're getting the team back together, right? Now, I'm pretty sure Mara hates me.
I think she's always hated you, but now she hates you a little more.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I know that you're probably going through a lot and that didn't feel too great.
At the same time, I know what Mara's going through. Listen.
What was that thing you wanted to tell me? The Pinky Promise secret thing.
I know what Mara's gone through because... Okay, can we Pinky Promise for real this time?
Yes.
Okay. Ooh, that was a good one.
Yeah, I learned how to do it. I'm so glad we don't have to cut off our fingers.
What?
Oh, it's a thing Charlie told me. I figured it out. Don't worry about it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, when I first came to the Rift, like I said, I was put under quarantine, but basically prison. I was interrogated for a month by
what?
All the elders. And they leashed me. They leashed me just like they leashed Mara.
Daniel, why didn't you tell us this?
Because they made me promise not to tell anybody. They told me that if I told anyone, then bad things would happen. And now I feel like they're happening anyway. And we all saw what happened with Mara last time. And I thought it was just because I was new, maybe, or I don't know, because I didn't follow the rules, but Mara has always followed the rules. She's been part of this school for, she's basically the everyone loves her. She's the best mage student in the school, and she still got-
Everyone loves her?
Well, I mean, she's like a really good mage, and now she got, she got punished like that, and-
Yeah.
I feel like if anyone finds out about me,
what do you
I
mean?
Don't know
that you were leashed in quarantine, if they find out about you, that what do you think's gonna happen?
You know those experiments I was doing earlier?
Yeah.
And you asked about the ring?
Yeah, it was bothering you.
The hunter gave me this ring. And
wait, what?
Yeah. She was the one that brought me through the rift. She was the one that died, and she came back, and now she's trying to attack us? That can't be a coincidence. Mara's right. It can't be a coincidence. I'm linked to all of this. I'm linked to the mountain lion. I'm linked to the hunters. Fee, I don't know what to do.
I'm just... this is... It's okay. I'm gonna help you, and we're gonna figure this out together. Are you sure we can't tell Mara or Charlie? I just feel like, you know, they're our friends too, and remember, I'm not very good at keeping secrets, and I don't like keeping secrets from my friends. Maybe they could help.
Fee, you pinky swore. And when we pinky swear, it's pretty serious.
You're right. I'm sorry. You're right. You trust me, and I trust you, and we'll sort this out, but I'm scared for you.
Well, I'm glad that you're at least on my side and you can help me try to figure this out.
Always be on your side, Daniel. I know what it's like to be new and not really know anybody. Also went through that kind of quarantine process. Not as rigorous as your experience, but it's very scary.
Sorry, I know this probably isn't what you expected when you got the news you're gonna get a new roommate.
No, it was so much more. You've been the best roommate. Seriously, and you've probably lasted longer than any other roommate I've ever had. So, I mean, there's that.
And it's from this pleasant moment of secrets kept and trust and bonds deepened that we move from this dorm room to Charlie's dorm room. Charlie, I'm gonna use my last hard move to inflict two conditions on you. Oh my God. I want you to be afraid.
What if
and I want you
was?
To be, well, I had you wipe everything but one.
Oh, everything, okay, okay.
Yeah. I want you to be afraid and insecure. Because now, after everything you've seen, everything you know, the outside world, the real world, is looking that much better. The real world hasn't tried to kill you several times in as many days. The real world doesn't need for you to save the lives of other people. The real world rewards you. Dante rewards you. Omnio rewards you. And you can't let go of that feeling, that worry at the end of your last call with him, that maybe your chance, your big move, that hope for the future might slip away. All he needs is an address, somewhere to send that tech. Get him that, and you can figure out the rest. You're smart, so smart. He's told you so many times how smart you are. You created a smuggling ring here. You can get that prototype to you. You just have to give him something. And you're running out of time. So what do?
I know I have one option to offer him. And so I'm gonna pick up the phone and I'm gonna call him because he gave me his number.
Thanks. And you call. And as you do it, you realize this isn't just calling Omnio. This is a direct line to his office. And Dante, you're in the middle of making 100 decisions that move $100 million in 100 different directions. But the line lights up. And it's Charlie King.
Lena, hold my calls, please. Thank you. Charlie, how are you?
Hi. Thank you for picking up. I'm sorry if I'm interrupting anything.
No. It's fine. What's going on?
Look, I know it seemed like I wasn't interested before, but I am. I want this more than anything. No one's ever taken a chance on me like this. I have an address to give you.
Charlie, now, I don't want to pressure you into anything. If this is something you truly want, I want to make sure that Omnio is going to get your full commitment.
You've got it. Definitely.
That's exciting. I'm over the moon. I'm elated. Wow. Okay, did you want to just email that over?
Yeah. As soon as I hang up, I'll send it to you ASAP.
Okay. I'm ecstatic. You are amazing, Charlie. I was worried that you weren't going to follow through, and here you are.
I'm sorry you ever doubted me. You will never have to do that again.
Can I just say that I feel that you are the future of Omnio, and you will be the success of our company.
Me?
And with that, Dante hangs up. And Charlie, you email over the address. Dante, you immediately call for a car and head in the direction of the address that she provided. And the camera moves along with you and all of your effects to a little condo in Santa Monica, a beautiful part of town. It's a clean, minimalist little place. There's tons of natural light, not a lot of warmth. It's nice, but it's not that nice. Not what you would expect the head of Redwood to be living, but all data, all important. And as you knock on the door, Dante, a short man, dark hair, a thick mustache, glasses, stern eyes, lined forehead, opens the door and immediately recognizes you. Oh! Oh! Oh!
Mr. King.
You are. Ha! You are Dante.
Hey, Aoki. Hello. Hi. Hi. What can I do for you?
Mr. King, happy to meet your acquaintance. Got a lovely place. And I'm here because I'd like to discuss a possible business venture with you and Redwood Capital and Omnio as well. I know I probably should have called or emailed ahead of time, but
I'm a bit more old-fashioned. Not at all needed. You are golden. Would love to do business with you. That sounds great. And he kind of just like leans against the door frame, sort of exhaling. He wasn't sure if he was in trouble or not. And it takes him probably a good 5 seconds to be like, oh my God, do you want to come in? Please come in.
Thank you very much.
And you see the decor. It's pretty minimalist. You can't quite tell if it's that way intentionally, but the sparseness. There's so few personal effects here. You can see a couple photos, most of them of Charlie, back when she was much younger, and one with the family all together. Charlie, Gerard, and a woman you can only assume via the genetic traits to be Charlie's mother.
Mr. King, may I call you Gerard?
Oh, absolutely. That's fine. And I will call you, I will call you Mr. Aoki.
We can be on a first name basis. Feel free to call me Dante.
Thank you. I would love to do that. Can I get you a drink?
Yeah, anything would be fine. Yes.
Absolutely. And he takes off for the kitchen, but this is like a large open concept, so he can still hear you, and you hear like the clanging. You hear a pot boiling. You hear like bottles being opened and like the fridge opening 100,000 times. And he's just sort of filling the open cavernous silence with words. They don't mean anything. And you wait. You are so patient as he comes back over a couple minutes later with a tray full of whiskey and tea and coffee and water. He didn't know what to do. He panicked. You're kind of a big deal. And he sets it on a tray between you and gestures for you to sit on like the most comfortable looking chair there as he kind of sits on the ottoman in front of you. So what did you want to talk about?
Well, I wanted to find out how Redwood Capital was doing.
You know what? We had a great quarter. We had some investments. Some of them weren't really working out. And you know, the economic downturn has been a thing, but we are prognosticating up all of this, just noise, but we super appreciate all of the hard work and the cooperation that we've had from Omnio and, you know, other businesses like you, not as good as you, but like you. And if we could deepen that connection, I know that we could have even bigger gains in the future. And I would love to talk. I'm talking a lot. I'll stop.
Oh, Mr. King, Gerard, my friend, you are, you're flattering me. You make me feel very special. I appreciate that.
Yeah, being in business with you, it's not too much to say. You are, I mean, you're not keeping us, you're not solely responsible with us keeping, but you're a big company and you keep us afloat a little bit, and I just appreciate doing business with you. I have a deck. Can I show you a deck? Can I get my laptop?
Before we get into that, I just wanted to ask you, how's life? How's everything going?
Other than right now and the small heart attack I think I'm having, I'm great. Things are great. You know, it's quiet. It's quiet. I like quiet. It's time to think. Lots of time to think and plan, prepare and plan.
Yeah.
Good time.
I totally understand that. Time is absolutely important. And I, you know, looking around, minimalism, it's my kind of man. Glad to know that you focus entirely on business, and it seems through those pictures of their family. How is family?
You see him get really quiet, and he doesn't seem to be as aware of how much time is passing between this versus all of those other answers. You know how it, maybe you don't know, it's, I don't want to assume. My wife left a while ago, and that's fine. It's just me and Charlotte, Junior, we don't say Junior. Her name is after my wife, Charlotte's my daughter. She's good. She's at boarding school. So she's doing good.
That's great. That's wonderful.
Family's good.
I'm sorry to hear that your wife left. I can understand running a business myself. There's very little amounts of time to spend with those and people who don't understand the lifestyle of goals and opportunity and ambition can, you know, they can find resentment in their hearts.
Exactly. It's hard. It's hard to balance. You know, you get it. You get it. And he puts his hand out and puts it on your shoulder and then looks at what he's done. And you see him break out into a cold sweat. And then he slowly moves it back and places it back on his lap. Sorry. I'm so sorry.
It's okay.
I don't want to, I mean, I washed my hands because I was making tea, but I don't want to get anything on your jacket, turtleneck. It's a nice turtleneck. It doesn't matter. Fashion doesn't. Oh boy. I am blowing this.
Gerard, there's nothing really to worry about. You're a little strung too tight. I'm going to get comfortable if you don't mind.
Oh yeah, please do. What can I help you with? What can I do for you?
It's very simple. I apologize. I should have admitted something from the beginning. I'm in contact with someone that you hold very close to you. Your daughter, Charlie King.
Wait, what? How do you know? How do you know Charlotte? Charlie.
Well,
she likes Charlie. Charlie. How do you know
Charlie? Well, Charlie is, she's applied for Omnio at an internship, and she's been here for weeks, and we're really, really admiring, and we're seeing such great potential in her. Really excited about the future with Omnio, having Charlie be a part of the team, and we're hoping to be able to bring her on and see how the future goes after her 4-year stint in her boarding school.
Oh, that's amazing. She never showed any interest. Not aptitude, she's brilliant. Mind for business. Didn't think that was what she... I am thrilled. That's amazing.
You should be thrilled. You should be very
great.
Thrilled. Because with the opportunity of Charlie being a part of Omnio, it presents a family tie in which you yourself and all of Redwood Capital would be benefiting. I just... I seem to find that there's a lack of transparency with Charlie. I haven't been able to get a direct address, and it's quite troubling.
Boarding schools. This is sort of it's a focusing school, you know, like a tech incubator where they drill down and you kind of just got to do the... She's at one of those, so they don't like when with addresses or calling or emails.
Gerard, that's wonderful. I'm glad that you know what she's doing, but what I need to know is where she's doing it.
Her school.
Yes.
It's just one of those things that it's super hard. Like I would absolutely send her things if I could, but even I am not hold on. You said that she's been working for Omnio and you for a couple weeks now?
Yeah? Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Some time
so you can contact her. I just, I can't help but ask, what do you need her address for? Sorry, I don't wanna, I'm not, no disrespect intended. I'm just, you know, she's my daughter and I'm protective. I'm a dad and I'm a dad.
We find Charlie's work ethic and creativity unmatched. She is beyond many of my executives at Omnio, and we're very excited to have her part of the team. Now, the times we've spoken, I've allowed for the absence of an answer to where her location is due to the fact that she is in school, and we are trying to make sure that she does have her time there to grow and become the woman she will be. However, there are prototypes that we have, and we've been trying to get into our hands.
Uh-oh.
And I need your help with a physical address. Now, she gave me this address. And I was hoping that you'd be someone that could give me an answer in this situation, although it seems that if I remember correctly, the two of you haven't been speaking much lately. She actually did say something.
I mean, that's all. Let me just jump in right there. It's, you know, I don't think you're a father. How old are you? What are you, like 20? You're not a father yet. Relationships between fathers and daughters are, they're complex. They can be kind of difficult. But, I mean, if she gave you my address, then I'm sure we work together. We have a excellent working relationship that, once again, I can go grab my presentation and we could deepen that. Sorry, I will focus. But if she gave you my address, then whatever you need to get to her, if you leave it with me, I will make sure it gets to her. You can count on me.
Mr. King, you're a businessman. You know how this works. I'm interested in Charlie's mind, but she has to offer. I need her as an asset to my company. Now, you can either help or you'll become an obstacle.
I would love it if you rolled persuade with best interests, please. As Mr. King gives you a look, conflicted between the opportunity that he sees in you, not only for his daughter, but for himself.
I rolled
and all of his instincts as a protective father.
I rolled an 8 plus 1, so a 9.
With a 9, you see superior. Something.
Sorry.
Yeah, plus your superior.
Plus 3, so an 11. I rolled a 12.
Good. With a 12, you know. You are so, so good at people. The reason this isn't a mundane role, this is a superior role, is because you have a superior mind. And people, they're not emotional. They're a series of wants and needs and triggers, and you are pushing every little want that this aspirational little executive has. And yet, you find yourself wanting, and you realize that it's not that he doesn't want to give you the information. He wants to give you the information, even against his better choices, but the truth is he doesn't have it. He doesn't have an address for her. He doesn't have an address for you, and that, more so than anything else, lets you know that where she is, even her last bit of family in the world couldn't follow, couldn't go. You know for certain now, Dante, Charlie King is in the rift.
Charlie did mention that you two don't really talk so much. She said it was nice to finally have an old mentor that really understood her. Looking around this place, I can guess she wasn't talking about you.
Excuse me. You know what? You are a very big deal in my industry and a lot of others, but if... You know what? No. You don't get to walk into my house and tell me about my daughter. Because you know what, sir? Even if... I wouldn't tell you. No. No, you don't get to have anything you want just because you think you are who you are. And everything I built, Redwood Capital, from the ground up 20 years ago, was to make a better life for Charlotte and little Charlie. And if I don't, even if you're threatening me and it, what would the point of that be? So no. I'm not going to tell you where she is. If you have something to give her, you leave it with me. And I will get it to her if I see fit as her father and her protector. We may not have the closest relationship, but she is my daughter. And I love her. And I will not stand for you taking this tone with me in my own house, sir.
Mr. King, you're pathetic. You can't hold a business together. You can't hold a marriage together. And your daughter doesn't even love you anymore. You don't even know where she's at. No. But I do. You've become a problem. And in my entire life, I've dealt with obstacles. I've overcome all of them. Now, if you're not willing to be the solution, I will make you the solution.
He knocks over the cup of tea that he was holding and it clatters to the ground, shattering, breaking this silence between the two of you, and he screams, "Get out of my house! I don't care who the hell you think you are!" And Dante, you turn, you walk to the door, and then you stop. You stop because he is just an obstacle. And you know what you do with obstacles. Dante never let an obstacle get in his way. That's how he became what he is today. And there's something deeper than that. Because what would Genesis do in this moment? He would solve this problem. And you reach up and pull down out of seemingly nowhere. A black mask covers your entire face, no eye holes. You can see just fine out of it because that's how the nanobots work. They give you a full heads-up display. All kinds of data. You can see how quickly his heart is beating. You can see his elevated temperature. You see ever so keenly him taking half a step back as your body is covered over with Vanta black armor that drinks in the light, and you throw this little, sad, pathetic man into your shadow, a shadow far bigger than he thought that he was facing when he opened the door to Dante Aoki. Yes, he is an obstacle. He was a problem, but now he's a solution. And as you move closer to him, everything for him goes to black.
To your house. Just give me a call when you get it, okay? Okay. Bye.